Hello, everyone.
Good morning.
Hello.
I'm too tired out from going up and down the stairs to give you much of a welcome, but it's wonderful to see you here today. So we have guests, we have people who really, I don't know, have ever been to, a service here. We have some dear friends from Crossroads, and from Park Hill and St. Paul's. Well, two of them are my parents, I have to say. So. And if you don't see my son, it's because I forgot to invite him. I sent him a message, I sent him a text message last night around, well, you know, the time, Susan, that you and I so often have communicated, like after midnight on Saturday night. I know, we're night owls, so he may come, he may show up, but who knows. Anyway, but welcome to you all. I'm so happy that you're here. So we have, we're going to carry out this service as if, you know, it's a service of worship, and we're going to do our thing, as we normally do. So we start with the life and work of the pastoral charge, and that's on the back of your bulletin. But something you won't see is a little announcement I'm going to make. It was dropped off at the church after the bulletin was printed. It's about an organ concert by Catherine Fraser. Music by Bach, Dubois, Leclerc, and Rink. Admission is a free will offering of non-perishable food and or personal care items. It's going to take place on November the 6th, which is next Sunday, at 2 o'clock at St. James Church on Joseph Howe Drive. My understanding is that is the Anglican Church at the Rotary, or the Roundabout as they call it now. But check it out just to be sure. But St. James Church, Joseph Howe Drive, November 6th at 2. So I wanted you to know about that. Okay, so now the life and work of the charge. Today there will be a reception in the church hall following our worship service, to which everyone is invited. A little reminder that daylight saving time ends early next Sunday morning, so set your clocks back the night before, or you will arrive at worship too early and you'll wonder where everybody is. You'll be with all the other ones who didn't set their clocks back, I guess. Park Hill is having a book sale on November 19th. The Reverend Trevor Phillips Memorial Advent Gospel Concert is going to be on November 26th at Emmanuel in Spryfield. The Park Hill Hanging of the Green service on November 27th will not only be the Hanging of the Greens, the first Sunday in Advent, but it will be a special service to celebrate Park Hill's ministry in the community. And again, the wearing of face masks is optional. That's the guy I mentioned before. My humble pardon to you. Anyway, you'll find out why later. Wearing face masks is optional. Although, please wear one if you are more comfortable wearing one, for sure. The bulletin is dedicated to the glory of God in memory of Vicky Gray from Teresa and Clyde, with a D. We do know who you are, Clyde. But our secretary does not know everybody who's in our church yet and does need spellings of names. So for future reference, just so you know. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
Maybe I'll use the mic.
Yeah.
As you know, we were involved in reuniting the Syrian family, the Khalaf family. Well, since that time, there was another case that came to the church, and we took that on as well. It's a case of Omar al-Abdullah. He'd been separated from his wife and child for 6 years, and he is stranded in Libya. Now, we've just received news that he's coming to Canada. He's got permission to come to Canada, so he'll be coming on the 14th of November to be reunited with his wife, Safa, and their five-year-old daughter. So we're rejoicing about that. So I hope that you will be able to meet him sometime in the coming months. I also want to say that we were involved in doing the paperwork and so on for getting him here, but that the Syrian community has kind of stepped up and taken the financial obligations. So we're not, that's why you haven't seen any fundraising from this end. But we're really rejoicing that this family will be reunited thanks to Sambro United.
Also wanted to let everybody know that there will be a minister in the pulpit next Sunday. We'll be welcoming Reverend Kathleen Anderson.
And also next Sunday's time change. So
time change.
Call back.
Any other announcements? Is Faith here today? Is Faith here? Oh, she's up above, okay. Well, would someone be willing to come forward? Oh, happy birthday. And are there any birthdays? Any birthdays or anniversaries? Now, Greg's birthday, it seems to me it's Halloween, isn't it? That's tomorrow.
Yeah, that means you have to come next.
Here we go. The verse is in the bulletin.
Happy birthday to you, to Jesus be true. May God's riches bless you.
Woohoo! We didn't. Thanks, Mary. Okay, so please open your bulletin. We're at Lighting the Christ Candle. The light of Christ is shining.
May it shine in our hearts, in our church, in our world.
Please stand as you are able for the introit. Call to worship. Please remain standing for the call to worship and the opening prayer. Let us pray. O God, we gather to worship you and celebrate our ministry together. Be with us and fill our hearts with love. Amen. And now we're going to sing 395. Come in and sit down. This is in the hardcover Voices United book. We're just going to do the first chorus of the chorus, the first verse, and the chorus, and that will be it. 395. Now we're going to have our scripture drama, so I'm going to ask Langley and Amelia to come forward. So Amelia, you're here at the pulpit. Do we have another mic for Langley to hold?
I'm speaking, so.
There should be one down front.
You want to come over here to the other side? So I had another microphone.
Well, here.
Oh. So if you wouldn't mind taking that, Langley, and then you can get it back when you're done. Okay.
One day, Jesus went to a town called
Jericho.
There was a man there named Zacchaeus, who was the chief tax collector. Everybody knew that he had gotten rich by cheating people, so nobody liked him. But Zacchaeus had heard about Jesus.
I want to see this man called Jesus. I've heard that he is really special. He heals people and cares about them. But my problem is that I am so short, I won't be able to see. I know what to do. I'll climb a tree so I can see Jesus as he passes by.
So Zacchaeus did just that. He ran ahead and climbed the sycamore tree. When Jesus got to the tree, he looked up.
Hurry down, Zacchaeus, because I want to stay at your house today.
Zacchaeus scrambled out of the tree, hardly believing his good luck. He was so happy to take Jesus home with him. The people who nearby couldn't believe it either. They said, "What business does Jesus have getting cozy with this crook? It's not right." Zacchaeus stood there, a little stunned. He spoke to Jesus.
"Jesus, I know everyone thinks I'm the biggest crook in town, but I have decided to change my ways. I will give half my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anyone, I will pay them back four times as much."
"Listen, everyone. Today this man has been saved. That is the reason I am with you, to seek and save the lost ones."
The gospel of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Midnight is falling, the signs are everywhere. The gospel that's burning, the sheep are returning to the shepherd's tender care. You are weary, so lonesome and weary with a load so hard to bear. Come to the Savior, there's rest for you there. The piper keeps playing, the chronicles paying as deep as sin they roll. Over and over the keeper keeps saying, "My child, you're not alone." Children keep straying, while mothers keep praying for love to leave them home. Come to the Savior, my sweet rolling stone. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Jesus was sent to the world by his Father to bring the lost ones back. Broken and battered, tormented and tattered, far off from the narrow track. Gently moved by his Spirit, and humbly he's asking you to obey. Simply receive him. God planned it that way. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And blessed are they which are hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. For they shall be filled. For they shall be filled."
Well, thank you. That was great. Woohoo! So what about that story of Zacchaeus or Zacchaeus or however you say his name? I think it's pretty interesting. And I was, the first time I heard it, I was a kid. And I was very interested because I was very short. And I really related to Zacchaeus, although I'm not so sure I would have climbed a tree. But I know that's something my husband Gary would have done, for sure. He's been climbing since he was little, he's still doing it. So, Zacchaeus is a short man, so short that in a crowd, he can't see Jesus. So, what does he do? Climbs a tree, yes, climbs a tree. So, have you ever felt too small, or too tall, or different from others? When you're in a, you know, you're around other people, could be a big crowd, could be a little crowd. Did you ever feel like you didn't quite fit in for some reason? Anybody ever feel that way? I hope I'm not the only one. Yeah. I mean, sometimes, you know, people have, what is it that attacks your fingers? And they're sore and you...
Arthritis.
I've seen people with arthritis who are trying to hide their fingers sometimes because they're askew, you know? They're hiding them because they don't want someone to see them, because they don't want to stand out and be different. So what happens when you look or act differently? What happens? I mean, something happens when you're a kid, something happens when you're a grown-up. Could be the same, maybe not, I don't know.
Sometimes you're overlooked.
Pardon?
Bullied.
You're bullied.
Sometimes people look at you and laugh.
Sometimes people look at you and laugh. It's true.
They try to ignore you.
They try to ignore you, yeah. All kinds of things. When people make fun of you or treat you differently if you're not like them. Some people do. Not everybody. Some people do. And as we say, sometimes they make fun, but sometimes they don't even notice us. But Jesus notices us. This is one of the big messages for today that I want you to take home with you. Jesus notices each and every one of you, notices all of us. And why do you think that would be? What do you know about Jesus that would answer that question? Why?
He loves us all.
He loves us all. Yeah, I know. So often the answer to the question is, Jesus loves me, and it's just like the hymn. But it's so true. He cares about everybody. And we may feel like we don't matter and we're not important. But we should know that Jesus thinks that we're all important. And not only that, wants us to know that it matters how we behave and what we do. So Jesus thinks we're important and that it matters what we do in the world. It makes a difference. It matters to Jesus, and it matters to other people. It matters to each one of us. How we treat others does matter, and that's people, animals, like your pets, dogs, your cats, all the creatures of the world, how we treat them matters. And it matters so much to Jesus that even though it's not the popular thing to do, Jesus lets Zacchaeus know publicly, that means in front of everybody, that he cares about him. And it's not the popular thing to do because Zacchaeus is a stinker. I mean, he's not a good guy. He just isn't. And when people see him coming, they go the other direction. And they say, what is Jesus doing even talking to this man, much less going home with him? So, what difference does it make to Zacchaeus? What difference?
Changes his life.
Changes his life. And how does that happen? It changes his life. So when you're thinking about it, what's going on with Zacchaeus inside him?
He thinks he counts.
He thinks he counts. So he's thinking about it. It affects the way he's thinking about, you know, how other people are thinking of him, how they perceive him. It's different from everybody else. So he's thinking about that. And I think it opens his heart, right? It's a change of mind, but it's a change. Just a change of mind really isn't enough when you're talking about Jesus. It's got to translate to down here, so that it changes your heart, so that you are motivated, so you want to do something different than what you've done before. So it opens up his heart. And I also want to suggest something that just came to me last night. It was an epiphany. It fired his imagination. Imagination is a wonderful thing, but it's an important thing, because it's in imagining that we dare to dream or picture something different in our lives. Now, Halloween is almost here. Anybody going to be doing something special for Halloween? Anybody going to get dressed up or go out? And yeah, a few people are here. You might get dressed up and be at your house and be there at your door when people come in. We used to do that. So it's a time when we imagine that we're someone else, right? So now I want to suggest we can imagine that we matter to God, and that we matter to other people, and that they matter to us. We can think about that in our minds. We can imagine it. All this different way of thinking about ourselves. And when I say about ourselves, it's important that we do think differently about ourselves, because there are people walking around who have a very negative way of talking to themselves. Like if they make a mistake, what do they say? Oh, you're so stupid. They're talking about, like, how many of you do that? Yeah, well, don't do that. Don't do that. The thing that you say to yourself should be just as kind as you would say to somebody else. Be kind to yourself. I'm not saying to spoil yourself, although that doesn't hurt either. But imagine that you can think of yourself differently. And if you can imagine it, what if it were real? What if it was the real thing? Because here's the thing. When people know that they're loved and valued, it can make all the difference in the world. It can make all the difference in their world. And that's what Jesus does. That's what Jesus does. He dares us to imagine something different and then make it real. So now, as you know, I love to segue into songs. So we're going to sing a song, and in your bulletin it tells you it's More Voices. That's the soft-covered book. It looks like this. You want to open it up, your soft-covered book. It's 45, You Are Holy. And all those who have musical instruments, play them really loud so we can all hear them. Number 45, You Are Holy. Please stand as you're able. So now that we're all tuckered out, we can take a time to rest a bit and reflect and think. Is there anyone that you would like us to lift in prayer today? Any person who's on your mind, in your heart? Marlene? Regina Moss. Regina is having surgery in about 2 weeks. Anyone else?
Could you put Emma and Mary?
Emma and Mary.
Catherine and Ashley.
Pardon? I can't. Somebody said something I couldn't hear.
Oh, you would. You would.
You would? Okay, yes.
For Rory and Phyllis, Diane and Rich.
Yeah.
And also from Facebook, lots of people are wishing Helene and Gary all the best in their retirement. And Roxanna asked if we could please say prayers for our mom and dad, Morris and Shirley. And Linda and her son that are traveling across Canada. And for those who are suffering with addictions.
Yes. Jackie and Doug. Well, we didn't forget them. They're in our hearts. They're in our hearts. They are. So, Cindy and Nick, you want to come forward?
Let us pray. Hello, amazing God. We know that you love us and you watch over us all.
We love you. We love you too.
And
thank you for our families, friends, and pets.
We thank you for our wonderful church and all the people in it.
Thank you for the ministry we have shared with Reverend Helene.
We are sad it has come to an end, but we are happy for the good memories that we have of our time together.
We pray for all the people who are sick or sad or hungry.
Please hold these people in your love. We pray prayers of thanksgiving for Nancy. And we wish Helene and Gary all the best in their retirement. We pray for people who are ill, David, Susan, Chrissy, Marlene, Regine, Emma, Mary, Catherine, Ashton, Yue, Murray, Phyllis, Diane, Reg, Morris and Shirley, Linda and her son traveling, and Doug and Jackie. We also pray for people in difficult situations and those suffering with addictions.
We now say the special prayer of Jesus.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Welcome, everyone. I just want to say a very quick thank you to all these wonderful musicians that are up here. It's not very often that the men outnumber the women in the choir loft, but it's happened today. And just to put a plug in, we do want to start up with choir again, or praise and worship band, whatever form it takes. So if any one of you, or if any of you know anybody that would be interested, we're very open to anyone coming and sharing their musical gifts with us, or just coming and singing if they don't feel that they're a great singer. That doesn't mean anything. I've been doing this for years. So anyone that wants to come up and just praise God with us, we'd love to have you here. We want to do another piece, and Helene and Gary's ministry here has been so music focused, and for me that's one of the highlights of their time with us, and one of the many, many gifts that they share. And we just want to reflect that in singing songs about God's love for us, but also about our love for each other, which is the greatest commandment. So we really sing this as kind of a shout out to them. They taught us a lot of wonderful music, and we enjoyed listening to them sing for so many years, and very grateful for it. It's been a real blessing.
Love is but a song to sing, and fear is the way we die.
People now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go, we shall surely pass. When the one who left us here returns for us at last. We are but a moment's sunlight fading in the grass. Come on, people now, smile at your brother, everybody get together, let us love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, now we love one another right now, right now, right now.
Pick up your fellow man, let him help you hand, put a little love in your heart. You see it's getting late, oh please don't hesitate, put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place, and the world will be a better place for you and me. Just wait and see.
Will be be a better place for you and me. Just the way and sing. Put a little love in your heart each and every day. Put a little love in your heart. There's no better way. Put a little love in your heart. It's up to you. Put a little love in your heart.
I always feel after the anthem that could be the end of the service, because that's the, you know, that is the high point, really. Because, you know, musically speaking, the music itself moves you, and the words say the message. You know, it's all there. Anyway, so thank you so much. That was so very beautiful. Now, we have something special that's going to happen. I'm going to do the invitation to the offering, but instead of singing, we're going to have an instrumental offering hymn. So, friends, God's love is for everyone. We offer our gifts in response to that love because we want to live in God's loving way in all that we say and do. And so now we're going to have an instrumental offering hymn today from Susan and Jennifer. So now, remaining seated, let's join in the prayer of dedication that's near the top of page 2 of your bulletin. Let us pray. Loving God, may the offering we give make a difference in the lives of others. May it be a reflection of our love for you and a sign of hope for the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So now we're going to have a presentation, I believe. Am I going to do bills first?
Yes.
Can I do bills?
Yep.
Okay. Yes. So, today we want to acknowledge how grateful we are to a man named Bill Stewart. And Bill is thinking, what? For many years, Bill and his wife, Fran, have been an important part of this congregation. As we know, everyone's important. But I just want to say, Bill and Fran have been a blessing to our congregation. When the pandemic started, we did our best to offer online services with the help of Greg Reinhardt and others. I will never forget WebEx. It will be forever burned in my brain. But I learned a lot about how to, not look at yourself on the screen, and also to copy and to paste. That may sound simple to some of you, but it isn't to all of us. So There are many things I learned, and also began and appreciated the patience of this man too. But anyways, I digress. But worship was limited because Susan and I couldn't be together to lead the service. After a while, public health decided that a limited number of people could gather to lead worship, and eventually Susan and Sarah and I became the core worship group, and I thank you so much for being there. Whew. So now, yeah, it's been great. It's been great. Anyway, Bill stepped in. I mean, he was looking the situation over, and, you know, he was thinking, okay, something has to happen. And he offered to pre-record services in the church so they could be placed online. Eventually, we were able to live stream services. And Bill occasionally, and still, he occasionally did both at the same time. He would have two different, you know, tripods going with a cell phone on one and a camera on the other, and he was just, boy, it's just amazing. In this way, we could continue our public ministry of worship, gathering all of you in, and as it turns out, reaching out to others beyond our congregation. We started with Bill took us on around April of 2020, and we've gone through various configurations according to the mandates of Nova Scotia Public Health and the United Church of Canada. That's 2.5 years of volunteer work, intense volunteer work that Bill has put in, where we went from here up there. I mean, it was just going like this. We had to be quick in what we learned and how we put it in place. And we've done it here in the sanctuary, and when we were undergoing repairs, we were downstairs in the church hall. We've been all over the place, and we've been around the community. And there he's been, setting up his camera and or his cell phone to live stream or pre-record, going home and spending hours, the whole afternoon and beyond, editing it, then placing the finished product on YouTube. Bill has pre-recorded remembrance services at the church that segue to the cenotaph. He's put in introductory segments to various services from around the community, like at the seashore, or driving along the road from Sambro Head to the church with the sound of Susan singing an original composition in the background. He's recorded the last three blessings of the fleet at the public wharf with his nephew Lou. Thanks, Lou. And then edited and placed them online. He's done Christmas Eve services, Ash Wednesday services throughout the year. And Bill has been spelled off for reasons of vacation and health by Kirk Moss and Gary Burns, and we thank them too. Thank you so much. So Bill has decided to retire. We put together a dream team. It's the live stream team, which is going to be Kirk Moss, Christopher Lee, and Mitchell Gray and Dylan Gray. And we're so grateful for them, too. But Bill, you've decided to retire, to step back, but you've been so wonderful to work with. You've been encouraging and helpful. You haven't been afraid to say what you thought, but in the kindest possible way. You've been our recorder and our stage director, our cheerleader, and our wise elder. Bill, would you come forward? Come on. What's it to?
It's a Visa gift card.
It's a Visa gift card. So you can put it towards what you like.
Your drone.
What?
Your drone.
You can put it towards your drone.
Especially at me. God love you.
So, are we ready to go? Should I have my mask on?
So I get the privilege of actually speaking on behalf of the board.
Into the mic, please.
Into the mic.
Yes, into the mic.
I can't imagine anybody not being able to hear me even without the mic. So on behalf of the board, I'd like to say a few words to Reverend Helene. But before I want to tell you a little story. Unlike yourself, you always have a little story. Almost 50 years ago, I met two teenagers at a church not far from here, who delighted the congregation with their music and joy as part of a larger group. Yep. As the story goes, these two people married and had two sons, each a gentleman in their own right. Little did I know we would meet them multiple times over the next 50 years. As years passed, I was again fortunate to meet them at church, where both became an integral part of the life of and groups and worship leaders. As time passed, their kids grew up. They headed off to another church, and she followed her faith and became a minister. As chance would have it, the same church they had left previously had an opening for a new minister. And the congregation and community were delighted. Here's where the fairy tale becomes unbelievable. The minister's return brought one of the worst hurricanes in this life's church and a world pandemic. One could joke and say she created both and brought them with her. Or one could praise the minister for her strength and guidance as she led the congregation through one of the worst, most challenging times in its life. This minister led the community through technology evolutions, through broadcasting services from one single person to an entire congregation and community. She continued to be instrumental as part of a core group of people who kept the church alive during the pandemic, while many shut their doors. During the pandemic, this minister's weekly messages were inspirational, relevant, and supportive, and carried many from isolation from one week to the next. She tactfully transformed this church into a place that felt welcoming, and each felt like they were a friend and a spiritual leader. If you hadn't already made the connection, these two people, kids of 50 years ago, are of course Gary and Helene. On behalf of the Board of Management, we sincerely thank you for your guidance, friendship, faithful leadership over the years. You'll be missed by the congregation, community, and members of fire. We wish you all the best in retirement and extend a huge thank you. May God speed with you both.
Thank you, my dear.
I think there's a, Barb, is there a fire pit? Some brother? I'm not going to bring it up to you.
No.
And Gary, could you start the fire?
Oh, thank you. Should I open it now?
Give
superior, they explain there's a beginning. Don't start.
And a lovely car, too. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I got a runny nose now. But I don't know. It started with Bill.
Well, it's the John and Pat show again. We've often been a John and Pat show over the years, so it's only fitting that we're here today. I'll go first. I'll let John shut it down. these are always hard things to do. I got to know Helene and Gary and their two little boys a bit because they were neighbors of my parents and my aunts and uncles over in Long Cove. Didn't know her real well, but I knew who they were. Saw the kids around and the big black dog. Can't remember his name.
Max.
Max, yeah. And when I decided that I was going to kind of come to church in this area instead of where I was going, I wasn't long before they got me on session and UCW and many other things. And guess who was there? And we got to know each other and became friends and worked together on many things. Now, Session wears many hats, so we met monthly and planned worship service. Oh, I should go back to the discernment. She decided that she took the calling. She got a call to be a minister. And I was privileged to go through her discernment with her, hold her hands at meetings where I was not allowed to talk. Well, that was a hard one. And when she graduated, I was very privileged to be at her ordination and to be part of the laying on of the hands. And then she went off to New Brunswick and stayed there a few years. And then we heard she was coming back locally and to Timberley area, the crossroads, and was there for several years. And then we needed a minister. And I was on the search committee. And we had a few applications, and boy, I didn't need to look at any others when I saw her resume. I was convinced we got the perfect person, and we certainly did. So with Session, we met monthly and planned worship services. We kept Sunday school going as best we can. We developed a pastoral care team and started it with a few, and there's three of us dedicated people, Diana, Ellen, and myself, that still do that. She encouraged us when we decided soup lunch was a good way to have people come to church without coming to church, but they would come week or monthly to our soup lunches, and it was community outreach. We did Christmas caroling, and on some cold nights, we drove around to people's houses and sang them a few songs and brightened up their days, hopefully. The last couple of years, we've had some rousing Bible studies. We've gone in and delved into the Bible in a various deep way that made us all look differently at our Bible. And then Helene said, if we didn't have enough to do, she said, what do you think about a vacation Bible school? And we said, oh, well, yeah, I guess we'll do that. And we did. And it was successful, and we had, the last year, I think we had about 25 kids from the community. That's not great. Many of them came to church on a regular basis, but they all came to Vacation Bible School, and they got church whether they knew it or not. And it was just a beautiful journey. And there are no words to say how much you'll be missed, how much you're loved, and it's going to be hard shoes to fill. As being on the new search committee, we're finding you know, that's going to be a challenge too. So anyway, but we know where you live. The one thing is when you live in the community, you can't escape for long. And we know that for the next year, year and a half, that you kind of have to be separated from us for a bit. So we promise not to bother you with church stuff. That doesn't mean we can't talk to you, have a conversation at Sobeys or where we run into you, but we know we can't do the church talk because she's not allowed and we're not allowed to talk to her about church stuff. So don't bother her about church stuff. Anyway, so we wish you all the best. We know she's not going to have a minute to breathe with twins coming her way, right?
Grandchildren, yeah.
Grandchildren, twins. And she also has they're working on the house and getting, and she thinks she's going to have some downtime. You don't get downtime when you retire. It only gets worse. Anyway, so we've got a few flowers for you from the session. We've got a little something for you, and just take that and look at it later, from the pastoral care group, and a hug.
Thank you, my dear. Thank you so much.
And take care. We love you.
Thank you.
As is always the case, I will speak more briefly than...
Yeah, right.
I should just explain that Pat mentioned that now that Helene is retiring, that she can't be a member of this congregation for the next year or so, and that's not because we want her to go away, because we would love her to stay and be part of this, but it's the church recognizes that sometimes it's really hard for a new minister coming in to establish relationships, the kind of relationships that are really important, the kind of relationships of love and trust and so on. If the old minister is still hanging around, because people who love Helene... It's hard advice, but it's wise advice to say to ministers who've been in the congregation, don't be coming around for a year, so that the new person can establish themselves and build relationships and so on, and so that's. It's not because it sounds mean to begin with, but it's not mean. It's helpful and healthy, and so on. I just want to add to some of the things that Greg and Pat have said, that it's been wonderful working with Helene on session, and in all of the countless ways that we've worked together for the official board and session since you came here, and I've been thinking, what is it that makes Helene so special? She is a wonderful collaborative leader. She didn't try to barge through and jam through stuff and say, this is the way we have to do it. She works through conversation, through discussion. She's a wonderful listener, and when she speaks, she has wise things to say. And so I was thinking this as she was talking to us today. She has this incredible capacity to stand up here Sunday after Sunday and talk to us about the love of God for us in a way that's direct and straightforward and not pretentious, and just speaks from her heart to our hearts in ways that that touch me, and I think touch all of us. And part of the thing that makes Helene, I think, so special is that she has, she's bright. I mean, she's a smart person, but she has this capacity of speaking simply and directly to us in a way that touches our hearts. And I think that's grounded in the fact that she's incredibly kind. Incredibly kind. And she's also brave. Greg described the experience that we had as a congregation going through the pandemic and realizing that if we were going to communicate to each other, we had to communicate at a distance. And that was going to meant that we had to become comfortable standing in front of a camera. And I can tell you, Helene did not start out being comfortable standing in front of the camera. We went through times in session where a number of us talked about how this was going to be difficult, and should we do this? Should we engage in this new part of new style of ministry? And Helene had some problems with that. And yet, when the situation presented itself, that this was the way, that if we were going to talk about the love of God for each of us through this pandemic, this was the way that we had to do it. And she bravely said, okay, let's do it. And she bravely became accustomed to it. Well, you made us think you were accustomed to it. And that was really, really wonderful, both in and of itself, but because I think that Helene's kindness and bravery has stood as an example to all of us. And I think in some ways this community is kinder and braver now than when Helene joined us. I think we've learned wonderful things over the years from your example and from the way that you live. Because if the main thing that we talk about is what Helene was talking to us about in the sermon, that even for Zacchaeus, you know, God's love was there. And God's transforming love. And I think that we've been transformed as you've shown God's love to us in the way that you live, in the way that you deal with us, in your kindness, your bravery, and your generosity. And we're forever grateful for that.
Thank you. It truly goes both ways. You know it does. Ministers don't talk about that very much, but we are ministered to by you. Happens all the time. In Sobeys parking lot, or no frills, or out in the parking lot here, or wherever, on the phone. I mean, it's a two-way thing. It really is.
You see what she's like?
It is. But it's true.
Generosity and in action. And damn it, I didn't speak For less than Pat did, I think. That's unusual.
But I do want to say that through it all, Gary Burns, my husband, has been so tremendous in taking part. Whether singing or whistling, you can always know that Gary's on the way, even if you can't see him because you can hear him. You know. Anyway.
Tell him his crazy jokes.
Oh, the jokes. Yeah, the jokes. So thank you so much. It has been a great, great honor and a privilege and a lot of fun, because I believe in having fun. You got to have fun or it becomes a drag, and it's never been a drag here. So Park Hill and St. James, people of both of these church communities have been my family, my church family. My own family are dear to me, of course, and other church families too. But thank you so much for your great welcome and the pleasure it's been to be with you. So.
If you'd open your bulletins, and I need an assistant here. So could you come up and help me? Just, there'll be a time.
Amelia?
Yeah, Amelia. There'll be a time. You can stay down there because I need you to light the candle at a certain point in this. Our minister, Helene Burns, is retiring. It's time to mark the end of her ministry with our churches in Sambro and Jollymore.
We give thanks and praise God for our ministry together.
I give thanks for all that you have given me during the 6 years of my ministry with you. That's 6 years and 3 months. I thank you all for the many ways that you have ministered to me during our time together and for your prayers that surround me as I complete my ministry among you.
Helene, we give thanks for all the rich joys of your ministry with us. You have brought wisdom, compassion, joy, and love to your ministry among us. We rejoice in the ways that we have been blessed by your time with us.
I thank God for the blessing of being in ministry with all of you. You have brought wisdom, compassion, joy, and love to me and Gary as we minister together among you.
Do you release this church from the vows and promises made at your covenanting?
I do, God being my helper, and I ask God to help me let go of my sense of shared ministry with you.
Do you, members and friends of this church, release Helene from the duties of ministry among you?
We do,
God being our helper, and we ask God to help us let go of our reliance on your healing presence among us. Amelia, this is your part. Helene, we invite you to accept this candle to remember us. Remember that God's light always burns within you. Go now, surrounded by our love and led by God the Christ and the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
And I feel like I should add that part of this decovenanting ceremony came from the United Church of Canada website, which John Henninger Shue and I tweaked a little bit to fit our own situation. And so some of these words are John's. I would never have described myself as, you know, wisdom, compassion, joy. That would not be me. I would not have said that. But John put that in, so I went along with it. Anyways, thank you, John, for that. And thank all of you. Oops. And now we're going to sing again. Yoo-hoo. So in your Voices United hymn book, the hard-covered one, please turn to 646, because we're going to sing We Are Marching, and we're going to sing in English, and then, is it Swahili? Swahili, and then in English again. So we are going to be brave enough to try Swahili together. Please stand as you're able. We'll wing it. Please open up your, please remain standing and open up your bulletin to the back page. We're going to do the decommissioning together. I'll be one, and then we're all the all part, okay? Let us go out celebrating God's goodness.
Let us go out with thanksgiving.
Let us go out with thanks living. And let us go with the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the joy of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. Amen. Our song for the journey.
Peace be with you. Peace forever. Peace be with you, my friends. Till we
So I'm going to go stand at the door in case some of you can't stay, but everyone is welcome to go down into the hall for a social time.